is dying without our deliver. Arise and pray, arise and pray. Till the whole world hears, till the whole world knows. Lord, send us out where you would have us go. Till the lost world hears, till the last one knows. The grace of God, the love that you have shown. Till the whole world hears.
Hello, and welcome to the Santa Ponsa Community Church online service. Our prayer is that you will be blessed this morning. God bless you. So, let's open our Bibles to Revelation chapter 6. And it hasn't been easy. It has not been an easy, to be honest, as we were meditating on He is wonderful. He is wonderful counselor. He is mighty God. He is Prince of Peace. I'm just like, yes. And then I was dreading getting back into Revelation chapter 6 because it's just not easy. There's some things in the Bible that are not pleasant because it tells us where the world is heading. It tells us what truly matters. And today we are going to talk about some of those things. And my desire is that, you know, obviously we want a bit of balance. As Michael and I were talking about, just the need for balance. And really the world is so polarized. But Christians are polarized when they start talking about the Antichrist, when they start talking about what's going on in the world and Armageddon and the things that are going and where it's heading. Some people are just exaggerating. Some people are getting the timing way wrong. And some people are just completely complacent about it. And they're all wrong. I think we need a bit of just balance in the whole thing, you know? And I'm hoping to do that to a degree. Obviously, I don't purport here to be able to fix everything, but to be able to just look at what does the Bible say? What does it not say? Right? So let's look at it. It says, Now I saw when the Lamb opened one of the seals, and I heard one of the four living creatures saying, come, with a voice like thunder, come and see. Now remember, this is the Apostle John. The Apostle John is being taken and he's being shown the latter days. Just like Daniel had been shown the latter days. He's being shown things that, you know, and many people think that this book of seals, these seals are actually a writing of the future, how things are going to pan out. And John gets to see some of this that is going on. And he says, and behold, I looked and behold, a white horse. He who sat on it had a bow, and a crown was given to him, and he went out conquering and to conquer. So the first seal, a man on a white horse. Now, any good cowboy movie? The guy on the white horse is the good guy. The problem is that here, as you keep reading, you realize that this guy on the white horse doesn't bring anything good. Right? So we have to be very careful because some people actually think that in this verse it's talking about Jesus coming on a white horse. But remember, Jesus comes with a sword, not with a bow. Right? So some people think it's Jesus. And most people think it is actually the famous figure of the Antichrist. The first seal, the Antichrist comes into the scene. And he comes, as soon as he comes into the scene, he comes into a time which the Bible speaks about, which is called the Great Tribulation, the great trouble that's going to come upon the earth. Now, you might think, oh, that's fantastic. Well, look at the movies. Look at movies like The Book of Eli. Look at movies like, this apocalyptic movies where cities are empty and they're overgrown with grass and things. I think it's written into the heart of man. I think people know in a sense, not in detail, but in a sense, where things are heading. But Jesus described it like this: for then there will be great tribulation, such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, nor ever shall be. And unless those days were shortened, no flesh would be saved. No flesh would be saved on the earth. To date, Second World War is by far the greatest war in history. It involved 61 countries, 1.7 billion people, 3/4 of the world's population took part in it. And it is estimated that between 60 and 80 million people lost their lives due to that war. And yet, Jesus says, such as has not been since the beginning of the world until this time, nor ever shall be. There will be something that will be even greater than that. Now, when we talk about the Antichrist, when we talk about the tribulation, there's three lines. If you're a student of the Bible, if you want to know what the book of Revelation, how it is interpreted in general basis, there's three lines of interpretation. We talked about this when we began. One is the preterist view. The preterist view is that everything that we read in the book of Revelation happened in the first century. The second view is the historical view, which that everything that you see in the book of Revelation is something that evolves and develops as throughout history. So actually, we are in the middle of the book of Revelation. And the third view is the futuristic view of the book of Revelation, which interprets the book of Revelation as from chapter 6 on, it's still to happen. Now, you would be like, well, Raph, what is your view? What if I was to tell you that I actually believe that all three have an element of truth in it? My pastor, Dave Shirley, always says, people don't believe what they believe because there's no evidence for it. So, if you take actually the name of Nero, and you, in the Aramaic, and you use the Hebrew alphabet or something, some weird equation like that, his name adds up to be 666. Oh my goodness, the Antichrist. So in a sense, what happened in the first century, it's a birth pain. It happened, and there is part of it. But what's happened throughout history, we've had many things. As a matter of fact, in John it says there are many antichrists that have come already. So these things, these sort of situations have happened throughout history. But what I cannot take is when people tell me that it is exclusively historical and exclusive preterist, and that the book of Revelation has been ultimately fulfilled. To me, it's obvious that the things described there have not yet happened in its climax. Of course, there have been an antichrist in the first century. Of course, there have been many antichrists throughout the centuries. But this last one will be the ultimate. The ultimate antichrist. So what is the nature of this man? Because to me, I'm worried. This pandemic has revealed things that I never thought were there as such. We've seen the church polarized. We've seen people frantic, panicking, and we're seeing people like never before looking for a leader. Someone that will be able to not destroy necessarily, but rescue. And I think sometimes when we look at the word Antichrist, we automatically think against Jesus. Which, of course, the Antichrist is against Jesus. But remember that the word Antichrist actually says in place of Jesus. So actually, the nature of the Antichrist will be someone that will come offering what ultimately only Jesus can offer. The Antichrist will come, and right here, he comes with a bow, right? What, have you noticed there's no arrow? So there will be military power, but no action. He will be a man of peace. He will be someone that actually will bring peace upon the earth. Look at 2 Thessalonians with me. This talks about the person of the Antichrist. And obviously the book of Revelation speaks more in depth about it later on. But we are talking about these seals opening up. But if you look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, you see the book, the Thessalonians thought that the Jesus had already come. They've been told this, the rapture's already happened. And Paul has to calm them down. Remember, the early Christians here in Thessalonians, they had been fed what? Fake news. Now, fake news comes from both ends, not just from one end. We have to be really careful with our information, what we believe. I'll give you an example. Remember, did you guys see my Facebook post on the storm? Well, that was partially true news. That was partially fake news. You're like, well, what do you mean by that? Well, the cloud that I gave you was not of El Toro. Actually, it was in Tarragona. It was in the mainland. But the pictures that I put there were actually from El Toro. But in the beginning, I thought everything was El Toro. You know, and we have to be very careful because nowadays a lot of things are going around, a lot of information that is just not true. But anyway, the early Christians had been fed fake news that Jesus had come already. And he writes them in chapter 2, "Now, brethren, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together with him, to him, we ask you not to be shaken in mind or troubled, either by spirit or by word or by letter, as if from us, as if the day of Christ had come." I want to tell you this, guys, that let no one deceive you, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first, and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. Here's the Antichrist, the man of sin. Not the spirit of the Antichrist that maybe has had brought many Antichrists to the world, but one ultimate man, a man of sin, the son of perdition. Notice what he does. He opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God, that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Now, this is really interesting because some people that are have the historical book of the historical view in the book of Revelation would actually say that when he sits in the temple of God, that it actually means the church. Now, of course, you got to think. After Israel was scattered all over the world, their main line of interpretation after, I think it was Origen and Augustine, people began to spiritualize the book of Revelation. People began to spiritualize when it talked about Israel, when it talked about the temple, because obviously Israel was scattered. It looked impossible that they would ever come back. But we don't have the liberty to interpret the Bible that way anymore. Because we realize that the promises that God would gather Israel back into the land it's not a spiritualization that we need. It's actually happened. In 1948, after the Second World War, Israel became a nation again. With the approval of Britain, with the approval eventually of the UN, and there they are, a nation. And you know what? There are ministries that just help the Jews go back. But you know what? All the elements for the temple are there. As a matter of fact, if you go, as you go down to the temple, I mean, from Jerusalem, there's a great hamburger place. My goodness, it's so good. But as you go down towards the steps, there's the menorah, gold menorah, right there, ready for the temple. And then there's the Temple Institute Museum, where all the elements are there. You can go visit them. And they have everything ready to be able to build that temple. And all you need is for the Jews to just go ahead and build it, and for that man to bring peace. Because how in the world, I mean, politically speaking, how in the world will you have peace in a place where there's people ready to give their lives if they even touch that temple mount with one Jewish stone? And yet, it seems like this man will be able to bring peace. And at one point, he will stand in the temple and just say, you know what? I am the Savior. Not against Christ necessarily. It would look like he is just someone that came. He's able to bring peace to the world. He sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Do you not remember that I was still with you and I told you these things? Verse 6, and now you know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness is at work. Only he who now restrains will do so until he is taken out of the way. Now notice, and the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. But the coming of the lawless one, so this Antichrist, how will he come? Is according to the working of Satan, with all power, signs, and lying wonders. Guys, does that not just, I mean, it just shakes me to the core in this sense. He will come as a man of peace, but he will come seducing. So that means he will give people what they, you know, he will seduce them into something. He will give them what they want, but he will come with signs and he will come with wonders. I mean, to me, what worries me in the time that we're living in is not the coronavirus. It's not the vaccine. It's the climate that's brewing that people seem to be looking for a leader. And people are looking for a savior. But there's one being provided that will bring peace. But remember, he will bring what Jesus only can bring, but he will bring peace on the outside, not on the inside. It will be a very temper, but he will do it with signs and lying wonders. So to me, I'm just shocked sometimes. Like, well, that guy, he must be from God because he did a sign. Well, not really. The Bible says that the Antichrist will actually do these things. And listen to verse 10. And with all unrighteous deception among those who perish, because they did not receive the love of the truth. Notice this. With all unrighteous deception. What is unrighteous deception? It means that he will lie to get what he wants no matter what, because he has no moral whatsoever. It's just pure unrighteousness. Let me just lie to get my way. And isn't that a little bit of the political climate all over the place now? But notice the key here, the danger, and what we need to cultivate in our hearts. They'll believe the lie because they did not receive the love of the truth. They did not receive the love of the truth. And notice verse 11. And for this reason, God will send them a strong delusion that they should believe the lie. So it gets to the point where God says to a person, you don't want the truth? You don't love the truth? You just want what you want? And then he says, okay, well, I'll give you what you want. What you really, really want, like the song says. And he will give them the lie. They will actually believe. God gives over. To me, that is the scariest thing of all. And that's why in our lives, it is very important that we cultivate a love for truth. I mean, have you noticed in politics lately, it's just like, and obviously I'm more aware a little bit for some reason in American politics, but have you noticed that with American politics, it doesn't matter what the truth is, it just matters what party you're of? Have you noticed that when you watch football, if your guy commits a penalty, you're like, well, I'm not sure if it was a penalty, but if it's the other way around, you're like, that was a penalty. You know, it is like we just get so fired up and we're always rooting for our team no matter what the facts are. There's very few people that you can have a reasonable conversation about their team. There's a guy that I talked to about, it was when Barcelona got beaten by Chelsea. And I was upset, but I'm able to talk about a game. And he was a Chelsea fan, a big Chelsea fan. It wasn't you, Martin. And then I was just like, oh, yeah, and Barcelona did not do so good. But you know what? I feel like Chelsea... And he's like, hey, don't talk about Chelsea. I bleed blue. My children bleed blue. But it gets like that. People just don't want truth. They just want what they want. And the scary thing is that God will give people what they want. So this is the nature of the Antichrist. Bringing peace upon the earth. Outward peace that doesn't last long. But here you have the first seal. The Antichrist comes into the scene. And the Bible teaches that he is a good guy, an amazing guy. And that's why we have to be careful not to be personality driven. But at the time, at the end of 3.5 years, the guy turns into a monster, the monster that he always was. In 2 Corinthians, it says that Satan disguises himself into an angel of light, and it's no wonder that his servants would disguise themselves as ministers of righteousness. So he will look like a guy that does what is good, what is right, but then he turns on you, and he's somebody else. Have you ever had a boyfriend or a girlfriend like that? It's like the dating stage. And they are sweet. They bring you flowers. They do this. They do that. And next thing you know, they are abusive can be. Destructive as destructive can be. Have you ever gone somewhere where they promise you great things and when you actually get there, it's not all that? I remember when I was a kid, I've been traumatized by this. My mom left me with this family. And the way that they managed for me to stay in this house was they showed me all the Playmobil and all the Lego. And I was like, oh my goodness, mommy, bye. Man, that door shut. It's not time to play now. It's time to do this and do this and do this and do this. And I was like, oh my goodness. And I never forgot that in my life, you know. What seemed so promising wasn't so promising. So look at the seals. Look at the seals in chapter 6 of Revelation. The rider has a red horse. The second living creature saying, come and see. And another horse, a fiery red, went out, and it was granted to the one who sat on it to take peace from the earth, and that people should kill one another. And there was given to him a great sword. It was granted to him, to the one who sat on it, to take peace from the earth, and that people should kill one another. Guys, it can go so quickly. I mean, look at Assad in Syria, if you guys are aware of that situation. I mean, here's a guy who studies in the UK, who marries a British Syrian girl who for all intents and purposes, just they look like a, like when they were coming into power, they look like a wonderful couple. And they have brought the most chaos into that country that you can imagine. People against one another. If you have an opportunity, there's on Netflix, no, not on Netflix. I watched it on Apple TV. I don't know if it's on Netflix. But there's a documentary called The Cave. And this 30-year-old girl decided to stay on the outskirts of Damascus. And she just ran a hospital there. And my goodness, they were bringing people, and you could hear the planes coming, bombing. But it's not just the planes bombing. At one point, they began to bring children convulsing and with just pale eyes. And she says, we can do nothing about this. It was chemical warfare. Chemical weapons used on his own people. And she says, how can I hold back the tears while witnessing humanity being destroyed in front of me? Silence is all over us over the random deaths. I tried my best to save everyone's lives. Everyone just wants to survive. They even fought to get on buses that will displace them from their homes. Can you see where we have reached? No one can imagine the things we've seen. Now, I don't want to study or work. I don't want anything anymore. Maybe just for a short while until I find what I really want to do. I'm thinking of going back to my parents. When the regime disappears, I will come back. I'm afraid that what I saw will haunt me forever. I'm afraid to open my eyes. I'll never forget the truth I lived through. I feel like I forgot. Forgot the importance of things there. I want to open my eyes and see light far away. Behind the ocean, we try to survive. We try to stay in our homes. That's all. I'm wondering if there's space for justice. I mean, this is 2 years ago. Local. Imagine when it's global. It was in March 2018, chemical attacks besieged eastern Ghouta, and people were forced to abandon their homes and fled to refugee camps in the north of Syria, where they are to this day. But here, this second man, the second horse, the same, probably the same man, just a different, you know, when you talk about Nero in Rome, you know, they actually talk about two Neros. Nero sane and Nero crazy. And here, this, the nice time that he had and just the brutality of Nero when he burned the Christians. Sorry to bring good news to you today. You know, it's just like, but you know, this is the reality. A great leader that will bring peace and that will turn on humanity. Because he's driven by Satan. Notice the third seal, which is the natural outcome of war and people killing each other. When he opened the third seal, I heard a third living creature say, "Come and see." So I looked, and behold, a black horse. And he who sat on it had a pair of scales in his hand. And I heard a voice in the midst of the four living creatures, a quart of wheat for a denarius, and a three quarts of barley for a denarius. And do not harm the oil and the wine. And here you have famine. Remember when the pandemic first hit? And people were in the supermarkets were empty, and people are just punching each other and fighting each other over toilet paper? I mean, it was crazy. Not me. I didn't need toilet paper. I needed quelitas. So I went to the supermarket and I brought so many quelitas that they actually went bad. I didn't even know quelitas went bad. You know what quelitas are, right? The little biscuits from Inca. And they're wonderful because you can eat them with sweet and with savory. They taste wonderful. And for me, we couldn't find yeast. We didn't have bread. So quelitas was the solution. But my goodness, you know, all of a sudden I saw in me a hoarding. And even the supermarkets had to say, "Hey guys, you can only take four items of one thing." Even the supermarkets had to set rules down because everybody was just for themselves, famine. But here, notice, do not touch the oil. And it just seems like they will be wealthy. They will be able to continue to maintain their lifestyle in a sense. The wine and the oil is okay. But notice, remember what I told you about how the book of Revelation starts, that it starts with the things that soon will take place, and the thing was not that it's going to happen immediate, is that when it happens, it will unfold very quickly. It will unfold very quickly. And when he opened the fourth seal, I heard the voice of a fourth living creature saying, "Come and see." So I looked, and behold, a pale horse, and the name who sat on him was Death. And Hades followed him, and power was given them over a fourth of the earth to kill with sword, with hunger, with death, and by the beasts of the earth. Now come on. Have we seen a fourth of the earth die yet? Just haven't seen it. I just don't understand how we cannot see that it's a futuristic thing. But I mean, a fourth of the earth wiped out. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who have been slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, "How long, O Lord, holy and true, until you judge and avenge our blood on those who dwell on the earth?" And then a white robe was given to each of them, and it was said to them that they should rest a little while longer until both the number of their fellow servants and their brethren who would be killed as they were was completed. So here we have martyrs. Now, incidentally, and we're going to tackle this afterwards, but these are not the church. The church at this point has been taken to heaven. In what I believe is called the rapture, where remember we read in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, it says, until he who now restrains is taken out of the way. The Antichrist, the devil, is being restrained. And depending which Bible you have, it doesn't mean that there's a contradiction in it. Depending which Bible you have, that word "he who now restrains," it's capitalized. Now let me ask you something. Who restrains the devil today? It's the Holy Spirit. Who else? I mean, do you think it's a man? The Holy Spirit's restraining. And it says that he will be taken out of the way. When did he come? Remember Jesus said after the resurrection, before the crucifixion, he says, I must leave and he will come and he will guide you into the truth. And then at the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came. And wait a minute. What do you mean the Holy Spirit came? Wasn't the Holy Spirit upon David? Wasn't the Holy Spirit upon Elijah? But he came in a different way. It says that all men would prophesy. It says that the young would see visions and the old would have dreams. And that, you know, they would all prophesy. So the Holy Spirit came in a different way and the Holy Spirit reigned in a different way. But he will be taken out of the way. Jesus said the Holy Spirit will come and he will convict the world of sin. What does that mean? Restrain. He will convict. There will be conviction. But he'll be taken out of the way. So in the same way, when he's taken out of the way, and the devil and he moves the Antichrist into the scene, in the same way that David had the Holy Spirit, Elijah had the Spirit, there will be people that will come to believe. But when they come to believe, it'll be believe. If you believe, you die. They say, this would have to be researched to a degree, but obviously it's not far-fetched, that the lifespan of a Christian in North Korea is 30 minutes. I think it's an exaggeration, but I mean, but the thing is that the moment you show that you have a Bible, the moment if you were baptized, I mean, that is death or a concentration camp for the rest of your life in North Korea. I mean, that's a fact. The lifespan, time, I don't know. But if you get caught with a Bible, if you get caught as a believer, if you get caught getting baptized, it is life of hard labor for you and your family or death. It's no wonder that in the end, these people that will come to faith. And you guys have seen the Book of Eli. It's quite amazing, you know, where this guy, Denzel Washington, he's just, there's desolation all upon the earth. And he is just an incredible fighter. And he just, all he wants to do is take this book, which actually, it's the Bible. He actually has the Bible. And he takes it to this great place to keep it in a great safe. So that people will always be able to go back to it. And I thought it was an amazing movie. I mean, kind of a lot of imagination. But in a sense, people will be able to realize once the church is gone. I mean, obviously, the church cannot remain without the Spirit. Once the Spirit is gone, once the church is gone, once restraint is lifted, it will go crazy. And then when people read books, whenever people realize, oh my goodness, the book of Revelation is happening right before us, they'll come to believe. But then, it'll cost their lives. And then we have, how many seals? Where are we at? And then we have the faith seal here. No, that's the one we just did. And now, I looked, and when he opened the sixth seal, and behold, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth on hair. And the moon became like blood, and the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree drops in its late figs when it is shaken by a mighty wind. Then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. And the kings of the earth, the great men, the rich men, the commanders, the mighty men, every slave and every freedman, hid themselves in the caves and in the rocks of the mountains and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him who sits on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath has come, and who is able to stand? Great earthquake. Just yesterday, there was an earthquake in Granada, 4 on the Richter scale. And a lot of people like were online and were recording YouTube videos, and so several people. And then you could see how they were shaking. Imagine a global earthquake. And the rulers. You know, there's a scandal right now in Spain that the vaccines have come. And obviously there's a different philosophy than in the States, because in the States they did Biden, they did as an example not to fear the vaccine. But here in Spain they said, look, it's going to be the older people first, and then those that are a little bit in homes, then the retired, and there's a protocol for who's going to receive the vaccines. But what happened is that the vaccines came, and then the mayors of the towns were getting the vaccines, and the chief of the Air Force got the vaccine. He just resigned yesterday. And then all these political leaders have been getting the vaccine, where it was supposed to go to the old folks' homes, and they've had to resign. Some with tears, they made me do it. But the fact is that they're afraid of the virus. They're like almost like Belshazzar. Remember we looked at it a couple of weeks ago where his knees were knocking, and it says that he pooed himself? It's like they're all shaken. And the moment you threaten their lives, everything is vanishing. They're just shaken. Imagine if a huge earthquake like that comes. Everything, everyone completely shaken. So we're landing. Well, I want to say one thing. Number one, because my thought was like, I just want to talk about Jesus. I just want to talk about the Gospels. I don't really want to go into the tribulation of chapter 6 of Revelation. I just don't want to do this. And then the Lord kind of reminded me, well, Jesus spoke about all these things. When will this happen? And it will be a sign of your coming of the age, they asked him. Jesus answered, watch that no one deceives you, for many will come in my name, claiming I am the Christ, and will deceive many. Jesus said, you will hear of wars, rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen before, but the end is still to come. So you have all these things that Jesus said, but now let's wrap it up. How do we apply this to our life? This is heavy stuff. You can see how you just want to go to church. It's like, oh, I'm going to church today. You know, I'm just going to share the good news. Croquettes. You know, just like. But how do we apply this to our lives? Okay, number one, what's the timing? When is it? And this is what I'm so, one of my great concerns at the moment is everybody's like, it's now, it's now, it's now, it's now. And since I've been a Christian, it's now. We have to be careful that we don't assume we always know the timing, or we don't become prey to people that are just love to fuel. They love to fuel. They love the mob mentality. They love the populism. It's now, it's now. And people, we are not to be unsettled. To be honest, I think we need to settle in our minds that we don't know the timing, but because we know what is happening, we can walk at peace that Jesus is on the throne. We can be like Daniel, that in the midst of the captivity, he was able to navigate it so lightly. He wasn't protesting. He was so amazing that he became the number two in Babylon. And with Artaxerxes, it was Nehemiah that wasn't protesting. He was just, with all the things that he knew was going to happen, he just worshiped God. And for us, what people need to see is not panic and alarmism. They need to see people that genuinely know God, genuinely are in peace inside and not panicking like everybody else, and actually love each other and not like what's going on, that the love of many grows cold. So the timing, we don't know. But we need to hold on to the promise that no matter what comes our way, the promise of Jesus is true. He will come for his church. Jesus describes the tribulation as a snare that will come upon. But remember what he said to the church of Philadelphia. to the faithful believers who kept his word, that he would keep them from the hour of trial. He actually said to them, you know what? Because you've held on to my word, I'm going to keep you from that hour. The hope that Jesus will come to get us, that ultimately Satan is not an equal at all. He will not prevail. And this should bring to us, listen to me, and we're finishing. It should bring into our hearts deeply the importance of a deep personal relationship with Jesus. Not nominalism. I'm a Christian on the outside, but inside I'm just do what I want. Not an idolizing of people. I'm a Christian, I believe Jesus. Oh, but my goodness, this leader, he's gonna rescue us. Ultimately, we need to get to the point where we realize that only Jesus is able to satisfy the ultimate needs. There's no political party, there's no political leader that will bring us what we're longing for in our hearts. Only Jesus will. So we have to stop idolizing people. And with that, in connection with that, we cannot be looking and expecting a human savior. So when you have a conversation with people, you should be saying, you know what, ultimately, no governmental power on earth will be able to bring what this earth brings. We need to get back to the point where we literally believe that the only solution for this world is King Jesus. And this will cause us, and this is the ultimate application, to have a loose grip on this world. A loose grip. If we invest in New York, if we invest in the restaurant, in the medicine, and to realize that ultimately all this stuff can disappear in a moment. Ultimately, it can all disappear in a moment. Times and seasons, you only have to look at history, change very quickly. I remember when I went to Cuba the first time, and everybody, all the Spanish people wanted to meet me, majority from the Canary Islands. Oh man, a Spanish guy. And I was shocked. Here they fled Franco and they ended up with Fidel. Look what happened in Syria. Look what happened in Libya. Look what happens all over the world at different times and stages. We look at the United States and think to ourselves, the great democracy of the world. Really? So was Rome. And it came down. And we need to get our eyes on that kingdom that's forever and keep a loose grip. Because what we see is going to pass away. It is what we don't see that actually is going to last forever. And what I mean is with our physical eyes, because we see the kingdom of God through the word, with our spiritual eyes. So be blessed. And we are blessed. We are blessed that although heaven and earth will be shaken, we have a living hope with Jesus Christ. Let us not panic. Let us walk in the reality of the gospel. Don't let Christians that are fanatics drive you in produce fear into you. God has not given us a spirit of fear of vaccines or virus of war. God has given us the spirit of love, power, and listen, of a sound mind. I mean, these guys that are went to the Capitol building in the United States, and they began to pray, Lord, bring justice! As they were trying to turn over the government in the United States. Those guys are not Christians, they're crazy. And we can be driven by crazy people just because they bear the name of Jesus. We need to be driven by the balance, clear, solid, good, righteous, powerful, hope-giving truth of the Word of God. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much, Lord, for your word. And we pray that you will have your way with us, Lord. We thank you that you are King Jesus and that although these are a reality, this Antichrist will come. There's no doubt about it. He's going to come. And there will be death and there will be war. Peace will be removed and there will be famine and there will be a great earthquake and a fourth of humanity will die. But Lord, help us even to realize that it will happen, but you will conquer. And this is so men will turn away from the reliance that we have on this world and we realize, and that we would realize that the only one worth living for is you who lives forever. Have your way with us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
capture my heart. I surrender my will. Focus my mind till I'm yielded and still. Hearing your voice to answer your call. Carried away till I can't speak. Carry me away.